This is a Seville AM/FM 8-track player, model 5401R8P, and I believe this thing's probably from the mid-70s, late 70s maybe, I'm not exactly sure. I'd have to find some date codes to be approximate on that. And this radio will run from 120 volts from the wall, 6 C-cell batteries, or a 9-volt DC car converter, they called it. You could take this in your vehicle, or wherever you had a 9-volt adapter. You got your plug-in from the wall, 117-volt AC. You have a earphone here at the top. This is where your 9-volt center positive wall adapter, or car converter, they called it, hooked up. Over here you have your tape slot. Here's a look at the back, being the battery compartment. And it looks like it's had some batteries leak in it. I bought this unit back in the summer at a garage sale for a couple bucks. And if I remember right, I think the AM radio worked on it. The FM, I don't remember, I'd have to play it again, did or didn't, one or the other. And I don't remember the 8-track player worked. I think it did. It's set to AM right now. Let's see what we can pick up on this jewel.
Gladys can agree to reset her life and so on. Okay, and
to Tri-States only, to Chevrolet. Press Explore Conversion Vans. That's Mike Hester, see Chevrolet.
Interesting.
Played all season long. At one point, he was number two today. He's playing a lot.
Even if it's a little
nothing, I'm talking.
Family with three kids before the first.
That seemed to have pretty good sensitivity on AM. That's our local oldies station on FM. Country station about 25 miles southwest of me. We've definitely got some issues here. We have no bass response at all or tone response on FM. Let's see if this tape will play. Seems to play. I don't sound very healthy.
Hello?
think she's going to need recapped. AM works good though. Well, let's shut the camera down for a second and take this puppy apart and see what we got. Taking apart the unit. And it looks like we've had a lot of damage due to busted batteries in the past. Oh, down in there is this covered in corrosion. A few of these caps. One right there is blown. That one's leaking. That one's leaking. There's one back there that's leaking. This thing needs new capacitors. I'm surprised it works as good as it does. I see at least three in there that are junk. But it looks like half the challenge is going to be figuring out how this thing comes apart. So, let's get to it. Believe it or not, digging through my stash, this is one of the few times I actually have almost every capacitor that I needed for a project. Usually I'm missing one or two and put in so many, and then I gotta go buy some or order them and wait for them to come. Luckily, in this particular case, the only one I'm missing, and I actually have it, but it's of a lower value voltage than what I need for replacement right here, is this 1,000 microfarad. I think this one's a 16 volt, and I've got 1,000 microfarad 10 volt. I'd like to stay either at or above the value of that capacitor. But I've got everything else from about 16 volts up to 50, so we're covered. Everything in this radio is anywhere between 10 and 16. I want to show you though, if I can get the camera to cooperate with me here. See the darkness at the back of them capacitors? Crazy. There's a couple in here that are newer capacitors. Well, they look newer anyway. And they're actually Nichicons. This little blue one here and here. And this one down here actually has one lead that's not even connected. When I spun around to get the value, it just come right off the circuit board like it was just barely soldered on. This one here has a date code of 1978. So, you know, that might be original to the machine, but I don't know. Most of the gray capacitors are Belcon. I'd never heard of those. I know there's a lot of different manufacturers back in the day. So let's quit yapping and get into this. Well, so far so good. Got four new caps in, about a half a dozen to go. I wound up having to either take it loose or cut it loose, the dial cord. That sucks. I took a lot of good pictures of that because I had to take this whole top off and rotate it. And it wasn't just no good feasible way of unraveling it and taking it off and paying the butt. But here's something I hadn't run into before. This is a 220 microfarad capacitor at 10 volts, and it's reading 001. That thing is absolutely shot. everything I've pulled out of here so far, the 470 read like 734. The other 220, I think it was about 250, 260. This 100 was almost 200. Crazy. Well, this thing even worked at all.
Well, it's going along pretty good. We got that little booger there changed. Got these three along the edge changed, and these two at the top. That still leaves us 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9 down here to change, but it's going pretty good.
Some of these little suckers can be pretty constrictive to get into. The one thing I want to pass along that I've picked up off a few other YouTube people that, members that post videos on here. And that's, just taking a basic old Q-tip. And soak it in some alcohol. And then just clean your solder joints up. Gets rid of all that old nasty flux, cleans them up real nice like. Only takes a second or two. That's all there is to it. As you can see, the recap is finished. It turned out pretty nice. Very compact little radio to get into, especially when the circuit board is mounted something similar to that at an angle. So we replaced every old capacitor except for this one here. This is a motor start cap that I do have the replacement for. I gotta pop this one in real quick before I button it back up. It's a 1,000 microfarad. I think this one's 35 volt. The one that's in here, 1,000 microfarad of 16 volt. Just got to pop him out and put the new one in. These old ones, you know, we had a mixture of... that's not one of them, that's out of something else. Too much junk. Belcon was a lot of the old ones. And that don't have a date code. There's a couple of Nichicons that was in here replaced. And they're dated... let's see here. 1978. So a couple of these, one of these at least, this one right here, only one lead was actually soldered in. The other lead, I'm looking at it up close, has no solder even on it. And that was this little guy right down here. He was just floating. So both sides have been soldered back in. That was a 4.7 microfarad at 25 volt. The new one's a 4.7 at 50. We had a little bit of smoking when I first started back up. And they had glue around the base of a few of these capacitors, but some of them were leaking. Some of it was glue, some of them were leaking. Exactly which, I think it was this one right here, had a little bit of smoke come off it. Well, it's got that glue on the side, so it burnt that off and it was good to go. And there was another one clear down here in the belly. I think it's that one right there. He smoked and left a little bit of darkness on the side of the resistor, but it's not nothing I noticed in it. It just did it real quick. So I don't know if that one is tied into what some of this down in here was, or God only knows. So it works now. This is FM band. Nice volume now. It still has a few quirks. The controls, be it the... this control here needs cleaned. That's the selection between tape and radio. This is the one between AM and FM. And the variable capacitor needs a little spritz of tuning cleaner down in there. But we're doing pretty good. Initial tests are showing a live victim here.
guys, I wonder every time I hear a song from Greece, nothing but good memories. I'm sitting with my daughter watching a videotape of the movie for the 100th time. John and Olivia on 70s on 7.
I got chills, they're both flying, and I'm losing.
On Saturday, you'll spend it in the park, no doubt. JJ with Chicago on 70s on 7.
Well, now that we know the FM band and AM bands are alive and well, let's focus our attention on this 8-track player. We have just a little bit of crosstalking in the channels, especially the 3rd and the 4th channel. And what I found out, this head rides on a magnet right, or on a, I'm sorry, rides on a pin right here with a spring beneath it, and it works up and down on that shaft every time the contact makes connection right here when you flip the, push switch here to change the tracks. This solenoid opens up, makes it click, and it throws the channel. The channels throw the head up and down. It makes it come up and down for each corresponding channel on the 8-track cartridge, is what I'm trying to say, just in long and roundabout ways. I'll just get to the point. Anyway, that slide was dry, and I got to recommend a product. And I, AM station engineer, you're responsible for me buying this. It's called Liquid Bearings. And I have used this stuff in more things than you'd ever think. It comes in handy for all kinds of stuff. So, a couple drops of liquid bearing was applied around there, and one down here on this eccentric that the solenoid rides on, and everything else is good to go. So let's see if we got tape operation here. Just a little bit of crosstalk, but it ain't near as bad as what it was. This is not a very sensitive radio in the aspect of low volume. Hear how garbled that sounds? You gotta turn it up pretty loud to get constant good volume. And the motor star capacitor has been replaced. It's got a brand new 1000 microfarad, 35 volt cap and line there. And this old capacitor, this one right here, this old Belcon 1000 microfarad of 16 volt, come out of this location right here. And when it was tested on my capacitance tester over there, showed up that that thing was at about 1700 microfarad. It was way over what it's supposed to have been. Every capacitor in this thing was pretty well out of whack. Sorry, go sleep. Sound effects on this A-track. All kinds of stuff on this. Now that the dowel cord's been reattached, which was a chore and a half on this thing, there's about, in my opinion, foot and a half more cord there than what it needs to make it do what it's supposed to do. What a nightmare. So, take a word from me, and believe me when I say this. Before you do any kind of recapping, take the damn dowel string off. You'll save yourself a lot of headache and hassle. Just bite the bullet and do it. It's a lot easier than trying to figure out after it's broke how it goes back on and how much tension this spring right here is supposed to have. It also helps to have a lot of pictures. Take pictures before you take any of this stuff apart. Unfortunately for me, I took mine after the dowel cord broke, so let that be a life lesson to you. At least for me, anyway. So, always take pictures before you take something apart. Anyway, that's back together. Got the dial cord back on and started noticing a few other things we had problems with. He had intermittent reception on the FM band. Well, I got poking around down in here. There's a few resistors on this circuit board. Let me point them out for you. You probably can't see them, but one of them's right there. Let me turn this up a little louder. That resistor was grounding out.
My name is Mark. Jackson says that.
There's another one back here. This one was grounding out.
Well, maybe he has more. Find out.
So we had intermittent reception on the FM band. Straightened all that back out. And I found a lot of that on this circuit board down in here. There were spots, and it was probably from me turning it around when I was recapping. And I don't know. I just don't. This thing is cheap. I understand that. And it shows it in spots. But other spots, like the tape motor and the way the 8-track configuration is set up in this little cheap bastard, it works pretty good. I cannot believe till, you know, I poked at it down here, the original belt's still on here, and it's in good shape. Certain things will surprise you on some of the cheaper stuff, and other things you'll be like, why did they do it like that? Well, 1978 was when this was built. We were on the downward spiral of cheapness in electronics. I hate to say it, especially in small portable throwaway. Probably this thing was only designed to last 1 to 5 years at the very most, and then it was time for it to go in the landfill. So, we got good reception on FM. I'm in my basement where my shop's at. Got decent reception on AM down here.
Of my life. Guy asked me on radio.
International Women's Day. Now going into this year. It's really going to be the guy with the first round.
That's a good oldie station out of Piqua, Ohio, right there. It's only about 35,000 watts. Yeah, 35,000 watts, I think, is what they run. It's hard to get where I'm at. I'm about 35 miles east, west of them, I'm sorry. 1570, WPTW. That's the only oldies music channel on the AM band around where I'm at. Occasionally you'll find one, but usually it's from a heck of a ways off. Some of the FM, like that's our large oldies station just a few miles up the road. Get that on the fillings of your teeth. I get it stood up and get it all put back together. Think it'll pick up a few more stations. And that's my Sirius. It's two floors above me. So let's stand this pup up and put it back together. See what it sounds like. And here's the finished product. We're all back together and cleaned up. New capacitors. This thing had a lot of damage due to broken batteries, and I think that's a lot of the reason why the FM band doesn't work right. Some of the circuit board is taking a bit of abuse, and I cleaned it up the best I could, but it still doesn't work quite right. Best way to describe it on FM, at low volume, the sound is real blotchy. It's very grainy sounding. Until you turn it up, and it gets pretty clear and pretty loud. So, we know that AM and FM works. What about the 8-track? Well, with the press of this tape, I violate YouTube, so let's get it done. I close my eyes. So, I hope you all enjoyed this look inside and outside of a 1978 Seville 3401 R8P AM-FM 8-track player. This was just a small project that I was kind of killing some time on, and it didn't turn out too bad. This is not a large, huge performer by any means. It's just a little carry-around 8-track player with a radio. So, like I said, it probably far exceeded its design specs by many, many years. I hope you enjoyed this video. And there'll be more to come from the basement shop before long. Thanks for watching.